Hello there, friends, and welcome. For today's BG3 guide, we have all about the Warlock class, with a very powerful Blaster Caster Warlock build that can achieve the ultimate Eldritch Blast damage possible. We are talking about 80 or so damage on a normal blast, double that on critical hits, and even higher than 200 when you make the enemy vulnerable, quite easily achievable later in the game. As a matter of fact, we'll get to combine both massive bonuses to Eldritch Blast damage together with a huge critical range increase. Last but not least, as a Warlock, you'll also be the class that has the easiest time instantly killing enemies by pushing them into the void, or dropping them down from high ground and distances. And I just wanna say that yes, this will prevent you from looting the enemy, but here's the thing, most enemies in the game, I'm afraid, only carry trash loot, that's right. Unless they are a boss or a unique name enemy, and well, it's pretty easy to spot those. Regardless, there's many strong hulking enemies that only carry trash, and you can easily one-shot them into submission. And don't forget, you don't have to do this if you don't want to, plus if they are dropped from a high ground, elevation, or into lava, you'll still be able to loot them. Lastly, this build will be capable of extreme damage regardless, right? It's up to you if you wanna have some fun. So without further ado, let us get into our Warlock Blaster Caster build and guide, first with the main mechanics behind the Warlock class. And for starters, Warlocks have a very unique approach to spellcasting as opposed to all other casting classes, right? First, they only have a limited amount of spell slots. For example, I only have 3 even at the max level. However, they get to restore all of their spell slots upon a short rest, just like that. Second, they can cast all of their spells from the same spell slots, that is. Armor of Agathys, a level 1 spell, will cost the same spell slot as Hold Monster, a level 5 spell. They share the spell slots. That's because for Warlocks, whenever they acquire a new spell level, they'll automatically upcast their lower spells to that level. For example, Armor of Agathys by default is a level 1 spell. My Warlock, however, can cast up to level 5 spells, which means whenever I cast this, it will automatically be upcast as a level 5 spell, right? For the upcast bonus you can see here. The same for a spell such as Scorching Ray, which will automatically get you fire more rays. 6 instead of just 3 by default. Now let's get into the other special Warlock mechanics. First we have their subclass, which is selectable as early as level 1. There's 3 choices, Fiend, Great Old One, and Archfey. Each offers 3 different benefits as you level up. The first at level 1, the second level 6, and the last one at level 10. The best choice, very early, is without a doubt the Fiend, right? Because of its unique Dark One's Blessing feature. Whenever you kill an enemy, it doesn't matter with what, weapons, spells, doesn't matter, you'll get a number of temporary hit points that scales based on your level. At the beginning it's just 4, but later it gets higher and higher. Temporary HP is amazing because it works like an energy shield of sorts that the enemy has to first deplete before actually reducing your true hit points. And with this, even as early as level 1, you have an easily replenishable energy shield, right? The second Fiend benefit is Dark One's Own Luck, which lets you reroll an ability check with a 1d10 bonus, but only once per short rest. Be sure to activate it whenever you want, in your passive stab, just like this. The last one is Fiendish Resilience, which lets you gain full resistance that's 50% less damage taken from any source, you get to choose it even, until the following long rest, so pretty much permanent. As you can see, on all levels, the Fiend Warlock has something useful, right? Well, the middle one is not that good, but the first and the last one certainly are. Fiend can also offer some unique spells, mostly powerful fire ones such as Scorching Ray, Fireball, and Wall of Fire, also quite decent. All of this is what makes the Fiend, to me, the best Warlock patron. Now, as far as the others, well, Great Old One can have a decent ability too. Whenever you land a critical hit on a creature, it and nearby enemies, although the area of effect is kinda short from what I recall, have to make a wisdom saving throw or become frightened until the start of their next turn. Frightened is quite useful too to prevent enemies from moving, while also applying disadvantage on ability and attack rolls. The problem with this is that it's tied to critical hits, right? And for a lot of the game, I'd say around 50% of it, you won't be getting that many critical hits with your Warlock. However, later, as you start stacking critical boosting gear, as I'll show you in the gear section of this guide, well, Mortal Reminder can be quite handy to have. The second Great Old One ability is called Entropic Ward, and it's quite useful. As a reaction, you can impose disadvantage on attack rolls against you, and if the attack misses, you even get advantage on your next attack roll against your attacker for one turn. The last Old One Warlock ability I find a bit disappointing. You have Psychic Resistance, which can be good, but the Fiendish Warlock could just apply it anyways, while you also reflect psychic damage to the enemy. It's just that not many enemies in the game deal psychic damage, including late game. As far as the Archfey, well, the spells can be useful, especially early, Fairy Fire and Sleep, but the main abilities are somewhat disappointing. Fey Presence is a small area of effect around your character that can either charm or frighten nearby enemies, but it's only once per short rest, so kind of annoying. While the second ability, Mist Escape, well, it can be useful, right? Because if you take damage, you get to become invisible, and then on the next turn, cast Misty Step to teleport away from enemies. So defensive-wise, sure, it's good. The last one, however, is subpar, Beguiling Defenses. You'll become immune to charm, okay, but not many enemies charm you, not at all. So to me, the Fiend is the way to go, especially for early game power, which I always find to matter the most, right? Because it's when your character will be at their weakest, especially on Tactician mode. We already know how Warlock spells work, but one of their most unique features is their special cantrip, Eldritch Blast. By default, you'll deal 1 to 10 force damage, which is nice because barely anything in the game resists force. Second, while the game doesn't tell you this unfortunately, at level 5, just like the other damage cantrips, the damage will upgrade, except instead of something like Firebolt, which just doubles damage, your Eldritch Blast will fire another blast, right, for the same amount of damage. And at level 10 it will become triple raise. This does matter because there is a lot of extra bonuses to damage you can apply on each individual proc of your Eldritch Blast raise. It's also great for getting multiple critical hits, right, because each instance will also fire an individual attack roll. Especially when you combine it with the unique Warlock Hex spell, which as a bonus action will make the affected enemy suffer an additional 1d6 points of necrotic damage per ray fired. And once that enemy dies, you can reapply the hex to another without a cost, once again as a bonus action. At the second level, you'll get another very unique Warlock feature, Eldritch Invocations. You'll start with 2, and later as you level up, you'll get to pick more from a bigger list too. But to me, the most important ones are without a doubt Agonizing Blast and Repelling Blast. Agonizing will make it so that your Eldritch Blast gets your Charisma modifier added to damage. Even as early as level 4, you can already acquire 20 Charisma for a plus 5. And remember, each blast of Eldritch Ray will get this bonus damage added on top. So at level 5, when you fire 2 rays at once, it's a plus 10. Second, we have Repelling Blast. It's, to put it simply, OP. It really is. Whenever you hit an enemy with your Eldritch Blast, it doesn't matter if they are huge targets like ogres and so on, they will automatically be pushed back almost 5 entire meters away from the point they were at. Now, this isn't just good for preventing enemies from attacking, because if they are pushed too far, they'll have to dash to get close to you, which eats their action, meaning they won't be able to attack that round. It's also the most busted ability for instant killing enemies by pushing them into the void, as I've covered in the beginning section of this guide, and trust me, there are so many different battles where you can use this to your benefit, including against most enemies that drop trash loot anyways. You can't go wrong by picking these two early. Nothing will compare. At level 3, Warlocks have another unique benefit, their Pact Boon. There's 3 different choices, and all of them have their own uses and benefits. Pact of the Chain is my favorite early, because it lets you summon an imp familiar, which is quite powerful early on. First, it can fly, amazing for movement. Second, it's resistant to physical attacks against non-magical weapons, that means it takes 50% damage against them. Most enemies in the game, even late game, carry non-enchanted weapons, so it's also good for absorbing hits. Lastly, its Sting attack can deal decent damage too, because if the enemy fails their save, they'll take extra poison damage. Pact of the Blade is quite useful too, but I'd say it's more for Warlock multi-classes, right? Not the classic Blaster Warlock, which is what I want to cover with this build. I'm saving a Pact of the Blade build for Will, the Warlock Companion, as I think it fits him better. Lastly, Pact of the Tome will offer you some unique spells that you can't really get as a Warlock. The problem is, for the first one, it's just some minor cantrips that are rather disappointing. I mean, Guidance, just have a Cleric cast it on you, and the other two are disappointing because you already have your Eldritch Blast anyways. At level 5, your Pact ability will be upgraded. For Chain Warlocks, your Imp Familiar now has 2 whole attacks per turn. Meanwhile, for the Blade Warlock, you'll get an extra attack with your Pact weapon. Quite useful, and also why a lot of Warlock, Fighter, Mage-like multiclasses tend to multiclass away from Warlock at level 5. Lastly, the Pact of the Tome Warlock will actually get 3 very useful spells. Animate Dead for summons, Haste, well, it's Haste, and Call Lightning, also quite efficient and nice for damage. If you are planning on remaining as a caster, blaster, warlock, to me, either go with Pact of the Chain, right, for the extra imp attack, or at this point, there is something to be said about respecing into a Pact of the Tome Warlock, because like I said, the spells you gain here are actually useful, as opposed to the initial cantrips. Also, do note that you can cast them individually once per long rest. They won't actually cost a Warlock spell slot. You'll get more Eldritch Invocations at level 5 too, with an expanded list. Mire the Mind can grant you Slow, which can help, because it's one of the best crowd control spell effects. Sign of Ill Woman grants you Bestow Curse, which is not that helpful. Armor of Shadows will provide you with infinite Mage Armor. Beast Speech grants Speak with Animals. Beguiling Influence is quite handy for proficiency with Deception and Persuasion, great for skill checks in dialogue. Devil's Sight provides you with Superior Dark Vision. I'd honestly just rather go with a race that has the normal Dark Vision, but that's just me. Fiendish Vigor grants you False Life at will, but if you're already a Fiend Warlock, well, your passive at level 1 already does the same except better, because temporary hit points will not stack from different sources. Mask of Many Faces provides this guy itself, you have a mask for infinite uses of it, and One of Shadows and Thief of Five Fates aren't particularly useful. To me, at this point, it would be either Mire the Mind or Beguiling Influence. At level 7, you get more invocations, and they're also rather subpar besides the ones I've already mentioned. At level 9, you have a very powerful unique invocation called Minions of Chaos, which will provide you with the Great Elemental Summon from the Conjure Elemental level 5 spell that you cannot get otherwise. At level 11, you'll actually gain an extra Warlock spell slot, so now you have 3 spells per short rest as opposed to just 2. At this level, you'll also acquire the Mystic Arcanum ability. It works as if having a level 6 spell of choice that you can cast once per long rest. It also will not cost a Warlock spell slot. This is because Warlocks are capped at level 5 spells only. The only way to get a level 6 one is through Mystic Arcanum. At level 12, you'll get your last invocation, and there's quite a powerful one here called Life Drinker, which empowers your melee attacks to deal additional necrotic damage equal to your charisma modifier. The problem is, for this build at least, well, we'll be going with a Blaster Caster Warlock, right? But for a Pact of the Blade Warlock that remained pure until now, so didn't multiclass, Life Drinker is certainly a very powerful pick. Now that we know all of the mechanics behind the Warlock class, let us get into character creation at last, first with race. When it comes to race, I've come to realize half-elves really are quite amazing for casters, because they basically combine the bonuses from being a human with more, right? Ideally, you retain the Civil Militia ability for proficiency with light armor, and also shields, which can matter for a caster for higher DC on your spells, and some higher AC earlier too, together with some of the best elven benefits, right? Dark Vision, Fey Ancestry can help a bit, but most importantly, if you go with the Wood Half Elf sub-race, you'll get increased movement speed. And well, movement matters for every single character built in this game. Ranged, spellcaster, melee, it doesn't matter, you always want more movement. So in a way, it's like having the best of both worlds. But as I said in my other caster builds, it's not like having shield proficiency is a must-have, it's just for 1 point extra DC. you can truly go with any other race you want. For cantrips and spells, please remember as always that I already have a best spells guide where I cover each in depth, you can check to the side here. Eldritch Blast of course is your main bread and butter ability, it will be your most powerful source of damage for the entire game even. The other spells are mostly for crowd control or minor damage in comparison. And Blade Ward for resistance and 50% damage taken from ranged attacks for defenses. Just pre-buff with it, it doesn't even require concentration. For subclass, the Fiend, as I've explained before. For spells, Hex is the most important one by far. The other spell is truly up to you, it doesn't matter much. You'll just be hexing and blasting very early. For stats, it's actually the same as my caster's sorcerer, right? They are pretty much charisma-focused casters at their heart and core. So 17 charisma, so that at level 4 it becomes 20, as always from the Hex gift, which comes from a boss battle at chapter 1 at the Swamp Cottage. Together with 16 dexterity, it's very important to have high initiative on any caster, especially a warlock for instant deaths and so on. 14 constitution is more than enough, but I like 15 so we can combine it with the resilient feat later. For your skill proficiencies, absolutely all the dialogue skills, right? Because we have super high charisma. So you can be the face of the party as the main character and make all dialogue checks easily. Intimidation, deception, and persuasion, of course. For the remaining ones, just pick an appropriate background. Guild Artisan, for example, gives insight and persuasion. Urchin, through sleight of hand proficiency, will let you easily disarm traps and unlock chests so that you don't need the staring on your party, it's up to you. What I can tell you is, insight has loads of dialogue checks, even if you have low wisdom. So proficiency into it can help. For level 2, feel free to pick any spell, right? Because very early you'll just be using Hex anyways. You can go, for example, with Protection from Evil and Good, even Hellish Rebuke, which I already picked. It's up to you. Now, for your first Eldritch Invocations, as I said before, Agonizing Blast and Repelling Blast are the must-haves, no matter what type of Warlock build you're making. For level 3, we have access to level 2 spells. First, you want Cloud of Daggers, which is the best area of effect option at this level. And even if you cannot move the cloud, well, you have Repelling Blast to push enemies right back into it anyways. Now, you want a second spell at this level, right? So go for Replace Spell, then change one of your level 1 spells besides Hex, and add Scorching Ray. The reason is simple. Because of Hex and effect, Scorching Ray fires multiple rays just like Eldritch Blast as it levels up, we get to apply a lot of extra bonuses to damage on every single ray fired. For your Pact Boon, well, I explained before, the best ones, right? But you may change certainly the best early. Any cantrip at level 4. You'll just be spamming your Eldritch Blast or Blade Ward anyways. And for another spell, definitely Misty Step, right? Being able to teleport to almost anywhere is especially useful for any caster, especially because it's a bonus action. For the first feat, well, since charisma is our most important stat and we get its bonus applied to multiple instances of our Eldritch Ray Blasts as damage boost, let us maximize our charisma now. As always, it will already be 20 with the Hag's Gift, even as early as this point. For level 3 spells, as always, this spell level is quite stacked. As a warlock, you have access to the unique Hunger of Hadar spell, which is what I would pick here. It can be quite useful, the area of effect is huge, it will automatically blind enemies inside, and also counts as difficult terrain, so they have somewhat of a hard time moving away from the area. And once again, you can just push them right back in with your Repelling Blast. There's some minor damage too, two instances even, at the start of their turn inside and also at the end. Inside the cloud, that is. As always, the best level 3 spells all require concentration, and you can also go with Hypnotic Pattern or even Fireball as a Fiend Warlock. It's up to you. As a matter of fact, I would rather replace a spell for a second level 3 one. In this case, I'd lose Protection from Evil or Cloud of Daggers, and grab Counterspell, always useful to block enemy spells from hitting you. But there's other choices too, as I've just said. Now, your level 5 Invocation, well, there's multiple choices here, and they aren't particularly amazing or anything, I'm afraid. Mire the Mind can provide you with Slow. Other than that, honestly, just Beguiling Influence for proficiency in Deception and Persuasion for dialogue checks, or Devil Sight. I'd go for Beguiling Influence myself. At level 6, for another spell, this is when I would pick Hold Person. The reason is simple, Hold Person, well, at first it only hits one enemy, but as you increase in spell level and upcast it, it gets an additional target. For example, as a level 3 spell, that's 2. Level 4, 3, and level 5 ultimately for 4 at once. Which means it starts to compete quite well with Slow or Hypnotic Pattern. Plus, as a Warlock, you'll always upcast it to the maximum anyways, level 5 once you hit level 9. But as I said, there's other options you can go for. For level 7 as your first level 4 spell, Wall of Fire is my pick here as a Fiend Warlock, as it can be quite a powerful concentration spell. Your other invocation also doesn't matter much, you'll only get a truly great one at level 9. But anyways, pick whatever you want here. Just remember Fiendish Vigor will clash with your Fiend Warlock level 1 ability. I just go for Mire the Mind just in case, for when you don't want to hit your allies with friendly fire spells. And as I said, you can pick it instead of Beguiling Influence earlier too. For level 8, any other spell you want. And for our feat, ideally I would go for Spell Sniper, right? Because it will increase the critical range of your Eldritch Blast, which matters a lot since we fire multiple ones per cast, each having a chance of being a critical hit. The problem is, unfortunately from what I've tested, at first I thought patch 1 fixed it, but it's not fixed yet, right? So it's not working. You won't get the critical range increase. Which is rather disappointing because, as I will show you in the gear section, you can increase your critical range by a lot through gear. I just pick the classic Resilient instead, which is why we started with 15 Constitution as usual for proficiency in Constitution saves. Warlocks, unlike Sorcerers, do not have it by default. And we really don't want to get disrupted, thus losing our powerful concentration effects. Of course, you can also choose to go for Warcaster for advantage on concentration checks instead, as always. For level 9, as our first level 5 spell, they're honestly kinda poor, I'm afraid. You are much better off using upcast versions of, let's say, Hold Person, Fireball, Scorching Ray, and so on. So pick whatever. I suppose Cone of Cold has its uses if you apply the Wet debuff to enemies first, to, let's say, Cleric or Druid's Conjure Water spell for double damage. But I'd rather Crowd Control. For damage, we already have our Blast. Hold Monster can be picked, it's just that it only hits a single target, but will affect enemies immune to Hold Person. Now at last we get another very powerful invocation. What we want is Minions of Chaos 100%. With this you get to summon the Elemental, exactly the same from the Conjure Elemental spell. And well, as I've already covered in my best summons guide, the Elementals are quite powerful. As for your Mystic Arcanum at level 11, ideally create Undead, right? Because it's yet another summon. And if you went with the Tome Warlock, you can combine the Mummy from this with the Ghouls, Skeletons, or Zombies from Animate Dead. It's just that the other ones aren't particularly useful for a Warlock. Any other spells? The same for level 12 spells-wise. Any invocation too, Life Drinker is quite useful if only you were a melee Warlock, right? But you aren't. I'll just pick Devil's Sight here. And as far as the last feat, well, you can go with Warcaster, as when you combine this with Resilient, you will truly never ever fail concentration checks, even if you are at late game. There's always Lucky to avoid attacks, and to me that's pretty much it. You could even increase your dexterity further if you want. Alright, now let us cover gear for our Blaster Caster Warlock. For the helmet, I'd say you have two choices. Birthright can be quite handy, just like for my Sorcerer build, to further enhance your Charisma. You have multiple sources that directly apply your Charisma modifier to your Eldritch Blast damage each individual instance even. On the other hand, the Hood of the Weave is the best to increase spell DC and attack rolls, by a plus 2, right? Both are Act 3 only, however, a personal favorite of mine for this type of build is the Covert Cowl. While you are obscured, you get to increase your critical hit chance by plus 1, which means instead of getting a critical on a 20 roll, you'll get it on a 19 to 20, which is quite handy because once again, we fire multiple blasts per cast, each capable of getting criticals. Being obscured is quite easy for a ranged character, right? If you don't know if you're obscured or not, well, this helmet makes it easy. Because if you're obscured, first you'll get the passive effect here above your character's portrait. Second, you'll see the smoke effect above your character. Anyways, this helmet is Act 2, but for Act 1, feel free to go with Fistbreaker Helm, 4+1 to spell DC and initiative, or the classic Warped Headband of Intellect to increase your chances of making intelligence skill checks by setting it to 17. For cloaks, the Cloak of the Weave as always, 4+1 to spell DC. I'm pretty sure there's also a cloak that increases critical range, just like our covert helmet here. But you have to be under stealth, and I'm not sure if it's currently bugged or not. For armor, just like with my sorcerer build guide, the potent robe is by far the ultimate choice if you want to maximize Eldritch Blast damage, right? Because just like your Agonizing Blast Warlock Invocation, it will increase the damage of your cantrips, including Eldritch Blast, of course, equal to your Charisma modifier, so we have plus 10 now when combining both of these, and static damage added to each individual Eldritch Blast ray fired. At level 10, that's plus 30, or even higher if you go with the Birthright hat, of course. Otherwise, you can also go with robes that increase spell DC, such as the Proctetic Sparkswall, the first one you can find. The Gemini Gloves can be quite handy, but in the case of Eldritch Blast, it just means an extra ray fired for a total of 4 past level 10. The problem is the benefit from these gloves is once per short rest only, so you can't really spam it, but well, you'll be recovering spells on a short rest as a Warlock anyways. So it does have its uses, at least for, you know, tough enemies or boss battles. The Hell Dust Gloves as usual can also help, 4+1 to spell DC, and the Eldritch Blast 2 hits chance, together with the Rays of Fire ability, also amazing when you are adding multiple sources of extra damage per ray. And early game, just the usual Gloves of Missile Snaring, right? To block most incoming ranged damage, your main source of danger as a ranged caster. For boots, I'd just settle for the Disintegrating Nightwalkers you get from defeating Trueso Nair at the Underdark. Because if anything, you can use Misty Step once per short rest, which is amazing for repositioning your character, or going for high ground. It's on a short rest too, which to me is better as a Warlock because you won't have to waste a precious Warlock spell slot with Misty Step instead, unless you truly need it. For amulets, ultimately the Amulet of the Devout, as always, for +2 to spell DC. Look, it's not Eldritch Blast boosting, but you still have a lot of powerful DC effects as a Warlock like Hold Person, Hold Monster, Hypnotic Pattern, and so on. Sadly, the Necklace of Elemental Augmentation won't really work because it doesn't boost force damage. And as always, don't forget the Spellcrux Amulet to restore spell slots. For rings, we actually have a lot of powerful ones. First, the Risky Ring, which, to be fair, is probably the most OP ring in the game. It only simply makes it so that you have advantage on all attack rolls, including spell attack rolls, such as Eldritch Blast or Scorching Ray. Advantage not only increases your chances of hitting the enemy, but most importantly, making critical hits, especially when you are stacking a lot of critical boosting gear. And it can be found at Act 2, so decently early as well. I enjoy combining it with the Callous Glow Ring, so that whenever we deal damage to an enemy, we also deal an additional 2 points of radiant damage, so long as the enemy is illuminated. And just like the other abilities that empower Eldritch Blast, this is an extra +2 per single ray fired. So at level 10, it's a +6, because you fire 3 pull per cast. Illuminating enemies is, well, extremely easy, right? I mean, all you have to do is cast the light cantrip on your tank. It's that simple. Lastly, we have the Coruscation Ring. Whenever you deal spell damage while illuminated by a light source, you'll get to inflict Radiant Orb upon the target, which is one of the most powerful debuffs, right? Because it's a -1 to the enemy's attack rolls per remaining turn. And here's the fun fact. If you fire Eldritch Blast at level 10+, even but once, you'll already hit the enemy with a -6 to their attack rolls when combined with the Callous Glow Ring. Even a late game enemy on Tactician with a -6 to attack rolls will have a very hard time hitting your characters. Now let's go for weapons and some useful consumables too. They do matter a lot for this build, because this is where most of our critical range boosting gear will be. First, the Knife of the Undermountain King short sword, which you can get at the Gift Crash during Chapter 2. Just like our covert headwear, it will increase your critical range by +1, And yes, it does stack. So now we critical on an 18 to 20 instead of just 19 to 20 or just 20 if we didn't have any critical boosting gear. The funny part about these passives that increase critical hit, right, is that they work even if you don't attack with the weapon, right? It's not just for this weapon in particular. For your Eldritch Blasts, most importantly, they will work. Ideally, you want to dual wield it with the Bloodthirst dagger you get by defeating Orin, who is one of the main story bosses at Act 3. Now, there's two other weapons we also need to cover. First, the Rhapsody dagger. Just like on my Sorcerer build, whenever you kill an enemy with this, up to 3 times, you'll get a +1 to attack rolls, damage, and spell save DC. Amusingly enough, it currently works even if you destroy objects. It's silly, but hey, it works, right? Anyways, the best part is this buff will remain even after you trade the dagger for something else. And the +3 to damage will be applied to each blast ray. Lastly, for the beginning of the game, the Spell Sparkler Quarterstaff can be quite powerful too, because of its lightning charge abilities on cantrips. And as a matter of fact, it can even stack multiple times depending on how many cantrips you fire, for great amounts of damage even early. Lastly, for ranged weapons, the Deadshot Longbow. Because once again, it will increase your critical range further, so when you combine all of this gear together, you'll be able to critical on a 16 to 20, right? 20 by default, 19 with the helmet, 18 and 17 with our dual weapons, and 16 with the bow at last. Ideally, it would be 15 if only the spell sniper feat was not borked and bugged at the moment, right? But for the future, be sure to keep that in mind. Now, as far as consumables, there is actually a very powerful one here, the Elixir of Viciousness, which once again increases your critical range by a further +1. As with all other elixirs, it's going to last until long rest, right? Which means you can benefit from it during multiple battles, especially later in the game. Of course, it's a consumable and you can't really craft an infinite amount of it, so be sure to save the ones you want for the tougher battles and so on. Well, alright friends, so this was it for my Blaster Caster Warlock build. If you found it useful, as always, please remember to like, subscribe, and consider becoming a channel member if you can. I truly appreciate your support. Thank you for watching, and see you next time, friends, with more fun BG3 builds and guides.